All right. Good afternoon, everybody.
Afternoon.
It looks like, well, we have quorum. I think there's still some people that will likely be coming in, but I want to go ahead and get us started. For the interest of trying to stay on time, given we have a number of things that we're going to go through and some of the pieces you're going to be presented with, since we didn't get those ahead of time, summer vacations and such make it a little bit tougher to get everything out. So I appreciate your patience with that. So I'm officially calling to order the meeting. I'd invite any changes to the agenda. The education portion will likely take longer, but that doesn't need to be a formal change because those are approximate times. The order wouldn't necessarily change unless there's anything anybody would like to change. If not, if I could get a motion to approve the agenda, please.
Hey, quickly, I apologize. I've got another meeting at 5. Could we have the...
Move the council updates?
Yes, please.
So perhaps right after board education?
That'd be great.
Thank you, Jonathan.
Yep.
Okay. So if I could get a motion to approve the agenda with the change of the council update coming after the board education.
So moved.
Thank you. Can I get a second?
It's Bob, I'll second it.
Thank you, Bob. Any other discussion? All those in favor, say aye, please, or raise your hands.
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so approval of the agenda with just that one change. I see most everybody has names here, so I don't know that there is anybody, but is there anybody here that was interested in public comment? Okay. And then I don't think, Kim, and please correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think we received the board minutes to look at to approve. Is that right?
I believe Kim just had to step away really quickly from her desk. I'll have to look. I do not believe that I saw them come through.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't. I know I didn't get a chance to look at them. So if they did come through, I didn't get a chance to review, so we'll defer that to part of the work that we'll do for the retreat. And then I'm looking at the list. I'm not sure if John Hall is here.
No, I'm sorry, he was not able to be here today. I'm going to try to get him on for our next executive and regularly scheduled meeting.
Okay, I imagine he is pretty busy getting caught up with everything right now, so
yeah.
I understand that. But we had the opportunity at the executive committee to meet Ramona. So Jim, would you like to introduce Ramona to the rest of the board?
Yeah, absolutely. So hi, everyone. I'd like to introduce Ramona Pinto. Ramona is our new program manager over the human services side of our division. And we're just really excited to have another person here to be contributing. And Ramona has jumped in right away. We've been doing program project monitorings for COC, so getting to know some of those projects. Ramona was very intrinsic in the cooling center setup, working with the libraries to make sure that all of that was organized. And Ramona, I'll let you say a little bit about yourself as well.
Oh my gosh, you know, I've done this so many times, it's like I get tired of hearing myself talk, but I've been in social services for quite a long time. I was senior center manager downtown So I worked directly with the homeless population that came through that senior center. Manager for the Meals on Wheels, taught out at Eastern, taught out at Community College, with a degree in gerontology. And I also worked for 6 years with the Brain Injury Alliance, working with resources to connect those individuals up and networking in the community. And I'm really excited to be with the staff that I'm working with. They're incredible people and have been very welcoming, and we're shaking things up. So
wonderful. Thank you so much for joining us, Ramona. Since we actually, things went a little bit quick since we were missing a couple of the things at the beginning. So it might be helpful for those of us who are board members to introduce ourselves just briefly to Ramona so that she has a sense of who on the call is a board member. And I will try to facilitate this looking at the list of folks that are here. I apologize if I miss anybody, but first I'll reintroduce myself, Adrienne Lighthouser, and I am the interim chair while our hopeful next chair is on maternity leave. So we have a new CHHS board baby that is with us too, with Jerry. And I've been on the board the longest. In fact, this is a little bit of an extension of my second term, and I'm also the current chair of the Affordable Housing Committee. So I'm going to pass it to the co-chairs first. So Bob, why don't you introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Bob Hutchison, co-chair. I've been on the committee almost 3 years, and then in my work life, I'm the executive director for Project ID, which serves adults with intellectual and developmental disabilities.
And Catherine?
Hi, I'm Catherine Alexander. I'm on the executive committee, but I'm a liaison from Community Assembly. So I'm representing the neighborhoods. I've been on for about 2 years. And I also sit on the HAS board.
And our new executive committee member and new member to the board, Karen.
Hi, Ramona. Welcome. I'm new to the board and now new to an interim committee chair role. And so that's how I came to sit on the executive team. It's a really supportive team, and I'm always impressed to see the background and information and experience that everybody brings to it. There's a lot to learn here, and I hope we'll all find a way to contribute.
Thanks. And Gordon?
Hi, Ramona. So I know Ramona, I've sat with her at several outreach events, most notably the Homeless Coalition meeting, which we both attended pretty regularly over the years. And, welcome aboard. And I'm still with Healthcare for Homeless Veterans, an employment coordinator. And I try to contribute anything I can from a VA veteran perspective toward the board.
Thanks, Gordon. Barb?
Hi, Ramona. I'm Barb. I'm a fairly new member, just the last 3 or 4 months on this committee, and I guess still trying to find my place on it. And I am in real life a registered nurse. Thank you.
Thanks, Barb. Kathleen?
Good afternoon. I'm Kathleen Terrell. I'm the director of Spokane County Community Services Housing and Community Development. And I represent the county as a member of this board. Thank you.
And then our council representatives are our councilperson Wilkerson and councilperson Bingle. Would you like to introduce yourselves as well? You maybe have already had a chance to.
I just welcome and thank you for stepping up to this really important role. Councilmember Wilkerson, I've been serving in this position for a little over 3 years, but in my real life, I run an assisted living facility for people who are mentally ill.
And I'm Councilman Bingle. It's my first term on the council. I'm about 7 months in. I represent the Northeast District 1. And my wife and I, we own a couple entertainment businesses here in town.
So thank you all. And we have three new board members who have gone through the interview with the mayor and will be moving forward to council. So we will be filling out this board more fully in the very near future. So welcome, Ramona. And I see John Hall has joined us as well. So welcome, John. Would you like to introduce yourself to the board?
Hello, everyone. I'm John Hall. I'm Director for Neighborhood Housing and Human Services. I'm starting my fourth week on the job, so I look forward to making the rounds and making your acquaintance. I've been meeting a lot of people and a lot of our collaborating partners throughout the Valley, the county, and the city, as well as some of the nonprofit organizations. So I will hopefully get to you sooner rather than later. Thank you for your participation on this particular board.
Thank you so much. I'm glad you're able to come in, and I think you caught most of the introductions of board members as well. So thank you so much for being here. All right. So the next bit of board education, Daniel, if you're ready, is the point in time count analysis. And I know some folks have had the opportunity to either attend a presentation or to go through that presentation. It's the really, really great data that they pulled together and did such a good job contextualizing the numbers in a way that hasn't been the case before. But I also know that some of you might not have had the opportunity to look at. So I did ask Daniel to just maybe briefly go through and highlight some things, remind us where to find this information, although you can always link to it from your agenda as well. And then be able to answer some questions if folks have questions. So with that, if you're ready, I'll turn it over to you, Daniel.
Great. Hi, everybody. Daniel Ramos, City of Spokane, CMS Administrator, and one of the data scientists on this project. What is my time looking like here? 10 minutes, 5 minutes, 15 minutes?
Oh, I would say 10 to 15 minutes. We're a little bit early anyway. So, yep, you have time. A little bit of time.
Great. Okay, I hope everyone can hear me okay. If my volume's too loud, let me know. This is the point in time count story map. So just a small intro here. This represents folks who are experiencing homelessness by the HUD definition. So it's not meant to include every displaced person. That's just not the aim of this. So much work and research to be done here. This is just one segment of it. So what is the point in time count? For those of you who may not be as familiar with the point in time count, you may know that we do it every year here at the city. It is a requirement for the HUD funding that we received for the COC, the Continuum Care Board, and the CMIS lead, and the collaborative applicant to get the point in time count completed each year. And it really is a point in time. So the last 10 days of January, we're required to do a count of those who are sheltered and unsheltered. Sheltered are those staying in emergency shelters and transitional housing, and the unsheltered are those you think of as staying on the streets and in places not meant for human habitation. If you go to the story map on your own, you can read a lot of these sidecars and take your time. With 10 to 15 minutes, I don't have a lot of time to read everything, so I'll go through and give you the highlights. Really the important thing right here on the methodology that I want to touch on is rather than doing the point in time count typically at the end of January, the last 10 days, we did it February 24th. And that's because of COVID. We had a spike, if any of you remember that, and it just wasn't feasible or safe to do it during that time. So we got an exception from HUD and did on February 24th. That's the night we count. So when we ask folks, where did you stay on the night of the count? We're really asking them, where did you stay on February 24th? Why am I calling that out here again? Because we do account for 5 days afterwards of the unsheltered, but we still ask them, where were you on the 24th? going through the story map here, the count really represents the entirety of Spokane County. We canvassed the entire county. We took a grid approach where we gridded out the county and cycled teams through and focusing on high yield areas first. That's where we know there was a high density of folks experiencing homelessness on the streets. And we used our data from 311 and encampment data to really show us where those high impact, high value sites were. So we cycled through those very quick. These are all of our partners. I want to say thank you. I always like to say thank you for the collaborators, EWU, Spokane Public Library, of course, and Spokane County and Spokane Valley, big collaborators on this. So thank you for their support. So the presentation is broken up into the what, who, where, and why. The who, this is really the core point in time count information that we report to HUD. So the total persons that we counted this year were 1,757. Total households that we counted as experiencing homelessness is 1,513. The household is lower because we usually have, I think in this case, it was 3.2 household size on average. And really, I'll get into some more interesting parts of the housing analysis. The slide I think that most folks are interested in is this one here. You can see that our count of the unsheltered was 823. We did not have an unsheltered count in 2021, but we did have one in 2020. That number was 541. So we had a 52% increase of those experiencing unsheltered homelessness on the night of the count. The breakout there of those staying in shelters and transitional housing, that's kind of a known figure for this group. We know our inventory pretty well here in Spokane. So that number isn't usually a mystery for us. So we know if shelters are full or close to full, we kind of have an approximation to that. I'll go into some of the additional population data, those who identified as having serious mental illness, substance use disorder, survivors of DV, and those living with HIV and AIDS. Those are required, that's required information that we have to gather during the point in time count, and you can see those numbers down below, a little small there. And again, I'll go through those a little bit more later.
And what did the ES mean up there where it said sheltered ES?
Emergency shelter, good question.
Thank you.
Yeah, good question. Emergency shelter, ES, transitional housing is TH. And just a quick discernment on what that is. Emergency shelter is really that 90-day emergency stay. Transitional housing can be as long as 2 years. So again, I encourage everyone to go through each one of these so you can look at that. These age breakouts, these are really HUD's buckets. So though families, singles, and children who were on the streets or in an emergency shelter or transitional housing on the night of count. I think the important slide here is our, and I'm hoping it comes through here, our count of veterans. I just want to say overall, veterans represent 11% of our county in terms of population, and they only represent 6% in our homeless data. So I say that's a real bright spot in all the work that folks have been doing. Kathleen knows this, who's here today. There's been a lot of work in veteran homelessness, and I think there's a lot to learn from that. And I know there's work being done to propagate a lot of those strategies for other populations. So I'm gonna skip to the where piece here. And this is really the unique piece about the story map is we were able to integrate geospatial information here. So basically for the first time here, we compared 2019 utilization rates in emergency shelters to 2022. This represents emergency shelters and transitional housing. Those green rings are the utilization rate for 2019, so how full those sites were. And then the pink ring is where they were at this year. And you can see this represents expansion and contraction of that occupancy for those sites. Where you only see one ring, a new project, where you see many rings, stacked onto the top of each other, it would be a facility that operates multiple projects. And you can really zoom in here and see what that looks like. And we can take, for example, and I won't spend too much time here. You can hover, you could see the utilization rate, for example, Family Promise, 79% there, and then it'll come up there, and 104%, so some overutilization. They were quite full in 2022. What about this? So this comes from our community management information system, and we looked, and I'll go quickly through this part. We looked overall, what is the shelter utilization rate over time, and going back from, I think this will come up, from 2019 to 2022, you can just see overall the utilization rate in shelters is up. It's trending upwards. We also wanted to check, you know, as researchers, was there anything anomalous or irregular about the night of the count for emergency shelters? So we ran the numbers. Really, that green line intersects with that February 24th date. You can kind of see it hit that peak right there in the sort of the third section of that graph. Pretty regular. So the utilization rate there was pretty in range for utilization rates for that quarter. You could see if we would have counted even just 2 weeks later, the count would have been just a little bit higher. So that's always a question. Was there something, you know, were shelters irregularly full or irregularly underutilized? No, we were right in range there. And when we teamed up with EWU and from help with experts here at the city, we asked folks who were staying not in an emergency shelter and not in transitional housing, why aren't you staying in shelters? And you can see that safety, fear, and of violence was the top reason for folks for not going into our emergency response system and staying the night in the shelter on that night. And I have two other presenters that are normally here with me, Dr. Anderson and Dr. Dietz. Dr. Anderson would tell you that that's pretty consistent with the literature of the last 30 years for why folks don't stay in shelters. This slider is really nice. I encourage, again, when you have time to do this on your own. We're comparing in green the point in time count of those who are unsheltered from 2020 to the count in 2022. So you can just see the volume is quite a bit higher, and we canvassed over and over again in a lot of different spots, and you can see that. Those counts there. You can zoom in to a pretty granular level here to look exactly where. So if you wanted to know, for example, how many unsheltered there were at the Freya encampment, Camp Hope, you can zoom in there and you can look exactly how many. So with that, this question gets asked every year. How many folks did we count who were unsheltered? Are from Spokane County. And you can see in those gumdrops there on the left-hand side, 74% of the 530 that answered this question who were unsheltered. So three-quarters of those that answered said that they were from Spokane County. 26% said they were not. Of the 74% that said they were from Spokane County, we were able to break that out, and 79% said that they last lived in Spokane before they became homeless. You can see the whole numbers down below, sleeping locations. Most of those folks were in outdoor encampments. And then other groups, this is all unsheltered, but sort of categories of unsheltered. 213 were on the street or sidewalk. And then it kind of goes lower from there. A lot of information to go through, and so I'm just trying to get to the highlights here. This graphic is important because 86% of those who were unsheltered said that they last lived in Washington State. And so overall, these two slides let us know that these are our neighbors and that this is a regional issue. Our unsheltered neighbors are in Spokane County, in the Valley, and in the city. I'm gonna skip through this. a bit here. This is what was really nice, and I think this is a jumping off point for other research, but we asked in what neighborhood of those who were in the city before they became homeless and on the streets, what neighborhood were you in? And you can see that the top three there were Browns Addition, Hilliard, and Spokane Valley. I think for those of us who work in this, that probably doesn't come too much of a surprise, for those neighborhoods. Again, this graphic here, to quickly go through it, it's a comparison from 2020 to 2022 of the unsheltered, and you can just see many more folks said that they were staying in an outdoor encampment this year compared to 2020. This graphic is interesting. I won't go through this one, but we looked at of those who were sleeping on the streets and sidewalks, or sorry, in outdoor encampments and street and sidewalks and vehicle, boat and RV. We asked them why they're not going into shelters to see if we could gain any insights there. So anyone who's working in the field or, you know, nonprofits, other organizations that are helping, maybe they can see a niche here where they might be able to support the reasoning there and get people off the streets and maybe into different programs that might meet their needs. So the why piece, I think this is one of the ones where most people are interested in. Here, let me just go through here. So when we asked folks the why the unsheltered group, why they became homeless, affordable housing was number one. And then substance use, you can see by the whole numbers there, was number two, and unemployment at 177 respondents. And I'll go into that a little bit more a little bit later here. I said we would go into this, so I'll stop here. 31% of adults reported serious mental illness on the night of the count in our data versus 4% of Spokane County in 2020. So that means we have a higher prevalence of those experiencing serious mental illness in this data set. But I do want to make sure it registers that 4% of Spokane County is, I think, 22,000, going off of memory here. So that's a big group. What does that mean? That means that yes, 31% of those experiencing homelessness stated that they had serious mental illness. That is likely underreported, and I've talked to some experts on this, and maybe our methodology here could be tightened up. But what does that mean? That means the 4% that live in Spokane County, those 22,000, not all of them are experiencing homelessness. So another way you can kind of frame this is there's a lot of folks who are experiencing mental illness who are not on the streets. And when we asked the question, as our research team asked the question, is mental illness and substance use correlated to a rise in our unsheltered population? The data just didn't bear that out when we looked at substance use, serious mental illness for Spokane County. It just really, the inflation there wasn't matching what we're seeing. And so we wanted to look at that at another angle. And I'm going to jump to a slide here that I think many of you have seen. We looked at housing affordability right away. And what you see here, this comes from the University of Washington. The housing affordability index is a composite score of housing costs and income. And when you're at 100, which is that middle line there, that means that your city is affordable. Anything beneath that and your city is considered unaffordable. Housing is considered unaffordable. And so we really dipped down back in 2017 from being very affordable in Spokane to less affordable. And in this last year, you can see we actually went below 100 and are not considered affordable by this index. And that purple line is the total count of those counted each year from 2009 in the point in time count to present. And you can just see that is just an inverse relationship with that housing affordability score. Again, this is not causation for statisticians out there or those who have that kind of lens here, but you can certainly see there is a relationship there. Going back up to the earlier slide, let's see, did I miss that here? You can see housing home prices have just increased dramatically since 2010 to what they are now. And I'm going to go ahead here and jump to another slide. This is median housing price and median income. And you can see median income just really isn't keeping pace with housing prices. And I always say, why are we comparing housing prices and homelessness? How do you thread that needle, Daniel? Where are you going with this? Where was the research team going with this? Well, really, the story here is that folks who would ordinarily be able to purchase a house within a certain set range are being priced out, and they're having to enter into the housing market at a lower range than what they ordinarily would have done in previous years. So instead of purchasing a home at $150,000, they're now looking in the $100,000 range. What they're getting for their money is in the lower range. And so folks that would have afforded a house are now in the rental market. And it's just a sort of a cascade effect on downward, so that folks who are trying to get off the off ramp of homelessness and into the rental market, it's just a tight squeeze. There really isn't the housing stock available for that. And I'm going to show you that in another slide. That one slide there is pretty complicated. Go back and read through it. It's very interesting. But this one here, if I can bring it up, it's quite small and I apologize here. But that orange line is the available the vacancy rate in Spokane, and you can see that we're below 1%, 0.8% in 2021. And those other two trend lines there, one is the fair market price for a one bedroom, which is $988, almost $1,000 for a one bedroom in Spokane. And you can see most federal housing programs, the cap for that, and that green trend line is $774. So the story there is that what the government is willing to pay for a one bedroom is there's a gap to what the market is saying it's valued at $1,000. Now, I won't go too much into, you know, how to fix that problem, just to say here that what this graph is showing us is sort of classic supply and demand. As supply goes down, the price goes up, which is what we're seeing here. Going on down, I know I'm slightly over time and I'm going quite quickly. I'll end with this slide. Which is when we asked those, the unsheltered group, what are the primary reasons for why you became homeless? Lack of affordable housing was number one at 56%. What's missing from the shelter system when we asked that group? They said permanent housing at 53%. And what services are you most in need of? Housing again was number one at 84%. And substance abuse is up there at 33% for a reason for why you became homeless. So I think there's work to be done in a lot of arenas here. And if we're trying to, you know, make data-driven decisions, this is a starting point for that. Thank you. I said a lot. I'm sure there's questions. Please ask them. Or if there's another slide you want me to go to, please let me know.
Daniel, thank you so much for going through this. And I'd like to encourage everybody to make sure that they take some time to go through this. But also, as you see in the next part, when we talk about planning for the retreat, part of what we're going to be looking at for planning the retreat is thinking about priorities for the next five-year RFP that's tied to funding human services. So some of the information that was brought together in this point in time count, such as some of the causes people cited for experiencing homelessness, would be good things for us to be reviewing as we consider that in September. Daniel, I had one question for you, and then I'll open it up to others. I don't need to pull back the slide, but I see that as far back as 2012, we were before, that was sort of before a very big drop off in vacancy, in rental vacancy, and in 2012 it was in the like 3%. But what's considered healthy for a rental market for vacancies?
Yeah. for vacancy rate, really, when you get below 5%, you're considered in a tight housing market.
So our housing market has been challenged for quite some time. A number of years.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Karen, I see your hand up. Oh, I think you're muted.
I know that this wasn't part of the study, but I just wonder, because of your background, Daniel, in the foster care system, I always have heard about the aging out I get this impression of just kind of being dumped out onto the city. And so the other story I always hear is that trauma is an almost universal background to the people who are in the situation or under the point. So I wonder if you know the impact of foster care, people who have grown up through foster care and age out, are they likely to find some other sheltered option, or do they in fact get, you know, what I have gotten an impression of, it may be very inaccurate, get sort of dumped out and become part of this, you know, hard life that people are living on the street?
Yeah, you know, I'm probably not the best person to answer that. I mean, working in CHHS, I do know of several initiatives and projects that are addressing youth homelessness and that population specifically, and there's a lot of work being done there. So I think.
Thank you.
If anything,
I'll watch for that.
I can tell you that there is work being done there, and quite a bit. United Way is leading that effort in many ways, in collaboration with us and other community partners. I don't know if Jen Saracini's or John, if either of you want to talk more about that, or Ramona, but there is work being done there, and thank you for bringing that up. That is a need.
And I would say that speaks to the limitation of the point in time count. If you only are looking at the point in time count and not this other information, is that often, and I think youth is sort of disproportionately experiences things like couch surfing or things like that. And the point in time count doesn't capture some of those numbers, right? So the point in time count is still underrepresented, and because it's the HUD definition, there's still some gaps. Other questions? Right. I'm not seeing any other questions. So, Daniel, thank you so much for joining us for this. And again, I'd like to, we'll have a bit of homework since we've got some extra time before the September 15th retreat to spend some time. There's really great information, and the team did such a wonderful job really contextualizing the information this year in a way that I think can be much more actionable than we've had the opportunity in the past. Keeping in mind, of course, that there is a gap because there was a year that we didn't do the normal point in time count, so there's some jumps, but there's still some important trends. I really appreciate the partnership with Eastern Washington to do some of the research to identify some of the trends, so that even though we haven't asked the exact same questions and didn't do this, weren't able to do this because of COVID in 2020 or 2021, that we're still able to look at how this fits the overall trends and things. So that's been a really great partnership. I really appreciate that.
Thanks, everybody, and thanks for producing some space to share this information. Thanks, everybody.
Yeah. Take care, Daniel. Thank you. Okay, so moving to the council update.
Well, Jonathan, I'll jump in. So good to see everyone again. A lot's going on, but a lot is the continuation of what's been happening. One thing that I think is really important, on Monday night, council passed a resolution for language access. We know that has not been unified throughout the organization. Every department had their own process. And so to really get that established within our system and make it accessible to all, since 2010, English as a second language has risen 9%. So we know it's on the rise. The languages that will be in this resolution is, of course, English, Russian, Spanish, Vietnamese, and Marshallese are the languages that we're initially targeting. And we get that data from the county based on the roles going forward. So look for more of that to come. And I'll just highlight that on Monday, we also passed the third tranche of ARPA dollars. And I'm excited that $5 million went to small businesses and $5 million went to nonprofits. So what is happening right now, I don't know if Councilmember Bingo saw his name, but we are working on the small business, getting ready to draft the RFPs and get those ready to go out because we know the need is great and we want to acknowledge that. And I have owned it. We should have done nonprofits first out the gate because there really was a big need. And then we'll just continue to do everything else. Also in that money was $120,000 for the cooling shelter out at Camp Hope. We see that there's going to be another heat wave next week. And so we just have to be prepared to care for our citizens as best we can. So I'll kick it over to Jonathan and let him go from there.
Awesome. Thank you, Betsy. A couple things I know that everybody here is aware, but, you know, the city submitted the proposal to the Department of Commerce, you know, for the $24 million that they've helped set aside to help relocate folks at the encampment on the DOT land near I-90. We approved, speaking of affordable housing, every single person on the city council recognized that this is a huge issue. And so we did approve an interim zoning ordinance, a 1-year pilot program to allow up to fourplexes in all single family zoning throughout the city. And so it's not targeting any one area. This is anywhere in the city. And as Councilwoman Stratton would say, she wants you to be able to pick the neighborhood that you want to live in and have it be affordable to live in there. And I think that this was a great move by the council. I'm really proud of the entire council came together to make this happen. We recently passed a resolution to require any future contracts with shelter operators to include a good neighbor agreement. And on August 15th at Finance and Administration, we're going to be briefed on the Guardians operator contract for the Trent shelter, which will be coming up here in a couple weeks. And we've been told that the shelter will be up and running by the end of September. But it feels as if we've been told a number of dates that haven't quite come through. I think they've told me 4 to 6 weeks my entire tenure in city council. And so hopefully it is by the end of September. Hopefully they can get it done. And then tomorrow at during the city council study sessions, we're going to be hearing from the city funded homeless providers. We'll be getting some updates there. And then lastly, the thing that probably would be interesting to this group. So council member Cathcart and myself proposed the sit and lie ordinance that was deferred indefinitely. And so that is no longer going to be discussed by the city council unless the majority decided to bring it back. So those are my updates. I don't know if any of that pinged anything else for you, Miss Betsy, but.
I will say on that ARPA dollars, we did set aside some money for, we are in contract negotiations with our city employees. We appropriate $2.4 million in back pay. Some of our employees were woefully underpaid and it was a challenge to recruit new employees. And that was a detriment to our whole city. So we're excited about that. And we have several more contracts coming before us over the next few months. So we want to get those solved and just go forward. So stay tuned. Did you have your hand up, Karen? You just didn't put your hand down.
Thank you both. Can I just double check the, is it tomorrow's study session that you're hearing from the city funded homelessness providers? Okay.
Yes.
And what time is that again? Is it
11? I don't know where it is in the agenda, but we usually go 11 to 12:30. It's somewhere in there.
Adrian, it is the second thing. We have an interview first for 5 minutes, and then the bulk of this will be 80 minutes to have an update from those providers. So you tune in by 11:10, you should be able to catch it.
Great, thank you. Any other questions for our council members?
To tune in to that study session, do we just go to the city website page? Thank you.
Yep, or you can go to Facebook, the City Council's Facebook page. It's live streamed there as well. I find it's a lot easier to find it on Facebook than it is the website. So
it's fewer clicks for sure.
It is. It is.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you both for those updates. So the next section is our discussion. I did send out a draft agenda for the plan for the retreat on the 15th. I'm not sure. I'm not used to Teams, so let's see if I can pull up that draft agenda so that everybody can look at it. But you should have it in an email if I can't figure out how to do that. I don't think I have permission to share. So I'm going to walk through really quickly what the draft agenda is, and it's super full, and we recognize that. And so we're going to try to make sure that we're creating as much time as possible to have discussions on these topics. One thing that I realized, especially for board members who've been on for a little while, that they maybe haven't seen recently is the board vision. It's always on our executive meeting agenda, but I don't think it shows up in the agenda for the full board meeting. So that's there for you, so we can get a sense that helps when we're asking questions about scope and that sort of thing. So first of all, I'd like to thank Bob for offering his location for us to be able to have this meeting on Pacific Avenue. And you'll notice that we did change the times just a little bit, starting at 11:30. But 11:30 to noon is really time to arrive and to gather your lunch if you choose to eat during the meeting. You're free to eat at the beginning of the meeting as well. But we will be starting the meeting firmly at noon and knocking out a couple of business items that we need to knock out. And then we'll talk about the rest of the plan for the afternoon. So, in our discussions, we sort of started off thinking in terms of strategic planning and then recognized that we have lots of new board members. We've not had a retreat for the last couple of years. There's really some foundational work that we needed to do before we could do strategic planning. And also the new board members will be invited, even if they're not able to vote quite yet, because I'm not sure when they're going to go before city council, but they'll be participating as well. So we sort of shifted to a little bit more foundational work to really understand the work of the board and the work of the department, our role, thinking clearly about where that division is between the CHHS board and the Continuum of Care board, because there's some overlap and some muddy areas, and we want to get a little bit clear with that. And then do some visioning and thinking, and this is why looking at the full report from the point in time count, along with some of the other reports that Karen shared with the group, linked us to the group after the last meeting, and we'll send that out again, that those things can be helpful for us thinking about, again, what our role is without going into a formal strategic planning session. So we're going to start off with some wins, some of the projects that we've done. One of the challenges of this board is an awful lot of the time we fund something, especially the capital projects, and of course those don't come to fruition for a couple of years later. And so it's good for us to be reminded of the sorts of things that we've been funding, the sorts of work that we have been doing. So we'll start off with that. And then we're going to spend some time looking at the scope of the board and the department, looking at a systems map. This will mostly just be information that we'll have to consider, and understanding the role of the Continuum of Care board as compared to or alongside the CHHS board, and what our board member duties are. There is one action item, and we'll unpack this a little bit more at the retreat, but there were some needs for some clearer processes for the CHHS board and the COC board, and those processes started getting implemented especially as there were sort of transitions in leadership. And so it stayed a little bit confusing. And so Jen has asked that we consider a clear proposal and sort of make the decision of, okay, what is our scope and what is the COC scope, so that we can be very clear with future RFPs and make sure that that's clear and we're on board with that. So that's the action item. And then one of the things that we'll do during this time as well is spend some time getting to know each other, but looking at our skills and interests of the board members, both to sort of map where we might have some gaps. So either we need to be looking for board members, or we need to be identifying opportunities for education where we might have some gaps in expertise, but also sort of seeking out what sorts of skills and interests do board members have, what would they like to be doing going forward. I mentioned, and I might be the only person who was a part of the five-year RFP. So nearly 5 years ago, we changed the human services RFPs from a yearly cycle, which was a headache for everyone involved because you spent so much time doing paperwork and things like that. Administrative costs were higher. So we shifted from an annual RFP for human services, it's the human services side of the work that we do, to a five-year RFP. And we're actually getting close to having to redo that RFP cycle again. The initial plan was that we would, the RFP and evaluation committee would have the opportunity to evaluate and perhaps make changes to some of our awards as necessary over those the years that the organizations were engaged in those programs. But with all of the staffing changes and leadership changes, that was outside of the capacity of the board. So we really haven't had an update on those currently funded programs. So we're going to start this part of the session with a report on all those programs that we funded and a sense of and include in that the original RFP, request for proposal, so we can see what the priorities were and we can get a sense of what it was that we were asked to do nearly 5 years ago. And then we're going to spend some time discussing based on our expertise, our understanding, based on the education we've had over the last year or 2 years, spend some time discussing some of the priorities for the next cycle of RFPs so we can start helping to inform staff of some of the things that we think would be important that so that they can take those things under consideration as they prepare for the next request for proposals, human services cycle. And those were the things we tried to narrow down what we're going to focus on. We felt that those were plenty, more than enough for the couple of hours that we have, but still hopefully gives us a sense to build a good foundation and a better understanding of what the board does and start working proactively towards at least the human services side of our funding cycles. So, executive committee, anything I missed? And then in general, any questions, concerns, or changes? Bob?
Yeah, the only thing I wanted to let everyone know is that shortly after the meeting ends, our program actually starts. So if anyone would like to stay and just see what we do, you're more than welcome to.
Thanks for that, Bob. That's a great idea.
That's very nice. Yeah, I think Adrian, you did a good job, Adrian, in helping us figure out who we are. I think that's really good. You did a good job with that.
Gordon?
Is the retreat 4 hours or... Two, you said in the 2 hours that we had, is the retreat?
Oh, I said in the few hours. Sorry, it's 4 hours. So it's 4.5 if you include the arrival and lunchtime, but it's a hard start at noon. Okay. So noon to four.
A few hours. I think it's a great idea to discuss everybody, give everybody a chance and talk about skills and abilities and maybe different ways we can contribute. And just kind of get a fresh start. I'm looking forward to it.
Thank you. Thank you, Gordon. Any other questions? So we have one more executive meeting before the retreat. So if you spend some time looking at this and you have some thoughts, please feel free to share, because that final exec meeting is where we'll make sure everything is firm. If you think of something after this meeting, please don't hesitate to reach out and we can see where that makes sense. Or we've also started a bit of a list of things that we are going to need to return to once we're done with the retreat. So what are we going to be doing in the October meeting, right? So if something doesn't fit in the retreat, but it's a natural connection, we want to make sure that we capture that as well so that we can address those things while the retreat is fresh in our minds. Okay, great. Councilmember Bingle gave us a little sneak peek into the next discussion item, and I'm not sure who is going to report on this from city staff, but we did want to just touch base about the zoning pilot that he spoke about. So I don't know if Jen's going to talk about that or someone else is going to, but if you could just share a little bit of the details of the zoning pilot and what that means, particularly as we're with our interest in affordable housing.
Yeah, hi, this is Jen. I'm not going to be the expert in this, since it affects us, but it doesn't live in our department. But I did see a presentation just this morning about it again, so I feel pretty confident I can replicate it. But essentially, the zoning pilot is going to allow for up for 1 year. It will allow for duplexes up to fourplexes anywhere in the Spokane area. It will also allow for, they're calling them attached homes. I would typically refer to them as townhomes, to be built in any area of the in the Spokane area, and with no limit of how many you can have attached, which is the rule right now. There's also some changes in terms of how you can utilize the space on a lot. And all of the goals of this is to see if we can start having some infill of multiple types of housing across the Spokane area where we've historically only had single family housing. And John, I don't know if you want to add anything else to that. I know you were at that meeting today too.
No, I think you hit it spot on. I would just emphasize that this is going to be a tool for us to increase rooftops, which will help with the lag of available units that Daniel talked about in his point in time count. And so I'm very excited about this new tool that we get to use for the next year, and hopefully we can align it with the resources that we have within CHHS.
I think I saw Catherine's hand first.
Uh-huh. I just have a quick question, and I'm wondering if there is a really rough guess we could give to the number of houses we would hope to see. Do we have some sense of the number of lots that are vacant, that kind of thing? Or are we just like crossing our fingers and gonna hope to see it works?
I'll just respond, Catherine. My crystal ball broke just yesterday, so I don't have a number. But what was written in that interim is to track it and see what we actually get out of it. So there
That'll
is
be good.
No number that I could even pretend to kind of kick out there. But in a year, we'll know if this was effective. If not, we can pivot and do something differently or go back. But it was really important. At the state level last year, the state was going to mandate these changes. So it's like control of our own community was being taken out of our hands. And it scared us enough to do something where we could chart our own destiny. And so I think this is probably just the best way to go. And that it passed 7-0 was like another amazing thing, because we have not all been on the same page about this. but with this, we were in total agreement.
Do we have any idea of how of the number of vacant lots we have in the city? Is there any way we know that or not?
Good question, Catherine, that we've all been trying to get an idea on. So we are asking facilities to kind of give us an overview of what's available. Part of the issue, if it is privately owned, they can't release that information because it's confidential. So they can't. So that's the challenge of giving us. If it's private property in the hands of a bank or the other owner, that's not really available for us to disclose that information on the public site.
Thank you.
Karen, I think I saw your hand next, and then Bob, I see yours as well. Come to you after thanks. Karen.
I just wanted to say thanks to the city council members and the city for pushing this through and getting this unanimous support. I think it's good for affordable housing, but also I think it will benefit the community because I live in Browns and it's a very dense and diverse neighborhood. And I think it makes it much more lively. And I think that this will help to improve the sterile feeling I get when I go in the suburbs. And also I had two questions. It's not this exactly, but related. I was wondering if there's an update on the effort to quantify and then get some control on the like the Airbnb type of rentals, which is, I know, affecting. And I may have missed it, Jen, in what you said, but the tiny house sort of thing, the auxiliary housing units, is that also addressed in the code, making it easier to do those? Thanks for filling me in if I missed that.
Yeah, so I've seen two presentations, and in the first presentations, ADUs were a part of that. That was not mentioned in today's presentation, and so I don't know if through the process that that was removed. Someone else might be able to better speak to that, and I'm certainly glad to follow up and see if I can find out more information about that.
Karen, I'll just tell you that was removed. Planning is working on that, so that'll be the next step. We could only bite off what we could bite off on this particular one, but that you will be seeing that probably the first of the year, because we do want to get a handle on Airbnbs in the city.
Yep.
I do know as an aside that the professor who is working with Daniel on the point in time count is also very interested in assessing the Airbnbs. And doing that work, so that there might be some of that research being done as well. So maybe we can follow up on that to your question, Karen. Bob.
Yeah, would this allow people that had a single home to consider demolishing that home and putting up a duplex or a fourplex in that property space?
Bob, it would allow that. Just because of the price right now, we didn't think that we would see a big wave of people tearing down properties and building, but that is an option for the homeowner if they choose to do that.
On that note, and this I think is also sort of tied to the ADUs, is it the case, I saw some report on this and there was one of the challenges was if you have a particularly deep lot that we had a rule about the fronts of houses being on the city street. Exactly. So if you had a deep lot, there was a problem. Is that still a obstacle?
That has been changed, and ADUs are really flexible right now, and it doesn't require.
Can't hear you.
Can you hear me? I'm sorry. No.
I think we can barely hear you, but yeah, I don't know if your microphone is having an issue.
Loud. Yeah, I lost my thought. Can you hear me now? But I lost my thought. But ADUs, we did address that. It does not require home ownership. That was the big deal before, that it was not utilized as much. And so that was the biggest thing. And the setback was addressed. And an ADU can be a separate building, or you could make the lower level of your house or the upper level of your house into an ADU.
Thank you. Any additional questions on the zoning pilot?
Adrian, I did want to answer your question about the facing the front, and that was discussed today that there was some items in place around that the door needed to be facing the front. There was some requirements around landscaping and, you know, keeping
the buildings in concert with the look and feel of the neighborhood. So those are definitely part of that.
Great, thank you. Well, again, I want to echo what others said. Thank you all for your work on this. And it's wonderful to see a unanimous vote and clear that this is an area that we are all, you know, in concert on in so far as one of the ways that we can build in some housing that hopefully can help respond to that crunch that Daniel was talking about in the point in time count. So thank you for your work on this. And I guess my other question is, you know, I know that Catherine asked if there was a number. So I'm not sure what counts as success, but I guess what's the next step after the year pilot? Like, can it just be extended or what happens and how will that be determined?
It can come back. It will have to come back before council. That's part of the ordinance. At that point, council will be able to vote to permanently amend the ordinance or let it roll back. So that's the safeguard. It has to come back for a vote.
Okay. Great. Thank you. All right. So the next two pieces, I assume I'm turning over to George, but maybe that's not correct, but is the CAPR and the annual action plan. For those of you, which I think most everyone was at the meeting, the last meeting, we had the presentation and we opened up for public comment. So the action items that we'll be looking for after George discusses whether there was any comments on these plans, the action is for us to approve of the plan with any comments. So I will turn it over to George.
And Adrian, actually, I'm going to take over for George. He is in a noisy area, so it might be a little hard to hear him. So he sent me some notes. So for the CAPR action, CHHS did not receive any public comment regarding the 2020 Consolidated Annual Performance Evaluation Report during the designated public comment period. And the action we need is to approve to submit the updated 2020 CAPR to HUD. And then for the annual action plan, as of the time of this briefing, we have not received any public comment regarding the 2022 annual action plan during the designation public comment period that began on 7/6/2022. The full public comment period is set to end on 8/7/2022, and we'll be providing an update to the board if any public comments are made in between the time of this briefing and the end of the public comment period. And the action would be to approve the submission of the 2022 action plan to HUD no later than Friday, August 12, 2022.
Catherine?
What this reminded me of is I would really like to have us put on our agenda at some point to really look at how we get comments. Because I think right now we're putting things in the paper that just does not work. And if we really want comments, we need to be way more proactive. I mean, this has been an issue for years, actually. So I really think that if we should think about it more deeply and see if we can come up with alternatives to really get people involved in making comments.
Thank you, Catherine. Thank you. Point well taken, and we'll definitely take that into consideration. The newspaper posting is actually a requirement of HUD that we have to post it in the newspaper. So that will remain, but I think we can definitely look at how can we beef up and improve the public comments.
Thanks, Catherine. Karen? Oh, you're still muted, Karen.
I took my hand down this time. Jeez. Thank you, Jen, for reporting. I wanted to say that I was kind of astounded when George shared with us how in all these years, I think he said the only comment he ever got was from Catherine. So I was talking it up a little bit. And I do know somebody that thought he emailed a comment in. So I was surprised to hear that there was no comment. I thought there was at least one. I wanted to second what Catherine said, and I have limited knowledge of all the avenues in the community, but I think obvious channels would be the city's Facebook page, which many of us follow, and the Homeless Coalition and the Community Council, which Catherine represents. And it would be so much better to get comment going in, you know, more information, as well as if there's a problem with the plan, you would hear that in the feedback to it. So I second what Catherine said, and hope that that will be more inclusive next time.
Thanks for that, Karen. Yeah, and I think this is what we can add this to some, maybe something that we discuss in October to start making some suggestions. I think one of the challenges is the public having an understanding of why this is an important thing for them to look at and comment on, right? So it is a challenging issue to figure out a way that you can drive interest in looking at a report that isn't super exciting, but so important. So I think if we can help make some suggestions, especially given that we're representing different parts of the city, that could be very helpful. Catherine?
I am wondering if it would be possible, maybe with Brian's help, to get an article in the newspaper about making comments and why it's important and how to do it and all that other kind of stuff. So just a thought.
I wrote the note down too, so that we can pick this back up. Thanks for that, Catherine. Okay, just a quick reminder, the CAPR, if you heard when Jen said it was the 2020 CAPR, that was, it looks like something that we basically didn't get approved through this process. So that was a past report that we needed to officially approve. So that was open for a shorter period of time, which is why that comment is already done. So the action for that, and it might be easier to treat them differently since they have different end dates, and the other one is still outstanding. So the motion for the CAPR, again, that was presented to us last month is to approve submitting the CAPR report.
Also move.
Thanks, second. Catherine. Thanks, Karen. Any other discussion? All those in favor, please say aye or raise your hand. Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So that motion passes. And now Jen, you might have to help us get the wording right for the annual action plan. So the annual action plan, we're approving submitting that report with adding any comments that come in between now and the close date, but submitting that report no later than Friday. And I'm sorry, I didn't write down the date that
August,
you said.
August 12th.
August 12th. Okay, so if I could get a motion to add any comments necessary, but approve the annual action plan submission no later than Friday, August 12th, please.
Okay.
Bob out there. And then Catherine, are you seconding?
Sure.
Okay, any other questions or comments? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye or raise your hand. Any opposed? Any abstentions? All right, that passes as well. So thank you for your attention to those two action items. And Jen, we've touched on some bits of it already, but we would love to hear your director's report.
Great, thank you. And I can see on here that the number one item is the commerce funding update. And this has been an interesting process, and John may have some additions to add in as well. After we went through kind of the gathering of the different thoughts and ideas of outcomes, the Department of Commerce is really looking to contract directly with those agencies whose proposals were included in there. So, for instance, Catholic Charities has already received a letter from
Department of Commerce for funding of their quality in changeover to a continuous stay shelter that would then transition to permanent supportive housing for folks who are staying at Camp Hope. So that one has been approved. I believe they're in talks with United Way around funding for the intake and assessment process. I don't think that that's been decided. And I'm not aware of any other interventions that have yet been approved. So we're still kind of waiting to hear. I did talk to Ted Kelleher earlier this week, and he is actually on vacation, although answering his phone. So I don't know if that's impacting it. And John, you might have some additional adds as to the progress with the response from Department of Commerce on the interventions that were suggested for Camp Hope.
Yes, and so I too spoke with Ted today. So and he won't be back until next week, but nonetheless, he basically is saying they've had some exploratory conversations with both United Way as well as Empire Health to be like a convener or he didn't use this term, but I'm going to use it, like the pass through, so that Commerce is not the one deciding where money goes. And so my interpretation from what he said, it kind of seemed like they were farther down the road with Empire Health as being a possible conduit, but that's my interpretation. And then the other is that, so I guess they're kind of waiting on that to be finalized before they award any additional proposals from what the city submitted. He did clarify that there, because I asked him about if there was an RFP out for nonprofits to apply directly to Commerce. And he said that was only in, forgive me if I'm pronouncing names wrong, I'm still learning the state, but Snohomish or something like that. It's only there that they are doing that approach. But that's the latest update that I have.
Karen.
I never stop having questions. John, thank you for introducing yourself and welcome to Spokane. I live in Brown's Addition, and as Daniel showed us in the point in time, we're a neighborhood that does have a very high percentage of the homeless people. And I have both volunteered for Catholic Community Services and I donate there, but I have to say there's a great concern over the lack of transparency or sharing of their plans in this neighborhood and in our neighboring neighborhoods. If there's anything you could do to encourage them to engage in community conversation so that this goes well, because Brown's Addition, for example, has many sort of supportive housing situations and you wouldn't even know they're here. They work great. And then, you know, there's concern that this might not be that way because they aren't sharing any information with people. So I really encourage working with the communities, and you might be in a position to help make that happen. So thank you for being here.
Right. Well, thanks for your comment. And, you know, I know that a lot of people weren't happy with the way this went down. And I think the city overall, you know, may have thought it could have been a better process. But my understanding is that this allocation of funds or availability of funds was only given a 10-day window initially, and then it was expanded. So it wasn't any time for community participation, which I think everybody from, you know, the state down to the city, we're hearing that now. But also I think from the awardees' vantage point, is probably, you know, anytime you're looking to do an acquisition, you kind of want to keep things a little bit quiet because the price may go up when the word gets out, so, and then it becomes unaffordable. But I really can't speak for them, but I know just in being in various communities and cities that has always been the struggle, you know, which, you know, how much communication do we do before we actually have site control? But those are things, you know, we take to heart, and we can continue to have those discussions to make sure we are trying to inform everyone at the right time. I know that there are some meetings happening. I think last Friday there was a meeting that was facilitated by Empire Health around kind of that conversation. Next week, I think on the 9th, there's a group that I'm forgetting neighborhoods. I think it's West Hills or Western Hills neighborhood will have a meeting where they've actually asked the city and some other stakeholders to speak on the on this commerce funding. So I will be speaking on that from the city's angle. And then I think there's yet another meeting, I think 2 days after that, because I was confused. I'm like, are these the same meetings? But for continued conversation. So I think everyone has the right spirit of cooperation, and we'll get there.
Great.
Any other questions about this funding? Okay, Jen, additional updates?
Yeah, sorry, I was trying to find my mute button. I do want to let you guys know that I have three offers this week that are going out for new staff, and we're very, very excited about beefing up our team and getting some extra folks in to help. So I don't have those fully nailed down yet. So I'm hoping that, you know, by this next meeting, I'll have some folks to introduce you to. So we're very, very excited about that. And then we've just been very busy with the COC NOFO, which has recently come out, and trying to get all of that through. We have a lot of contract renewals that are going through right now. And as soon as we get some of these folks on, we're going to be ramping up on releasing a new five-year RFP because we're in the last year of that five-year process right now. So that might be something that maybe we can discuss at the retreat around priorities for that and establishing kind of, you know, what we want to prioritize for those funds going forward. So those are my main updates, and I'm also happy to answer any other questions.
Jen, I had a quick question. I know Councilmember Bingle talked a little bit about the timing for the Trent shelter. I'm curious about, given that the Salvation Army stepped back, what is the plan for the providers?
We actually just re-released a shelter provider RFP. That just was out on Monday. And we have a couple interested parties that have expressed interest. They've not submitted their applications yet. We are moving forward with taking the shelter operator contract with the Guardians to council on August 15th, with the understanding that we're currently in open, you know, RFP for shelter provider. The goal was originally we wanted to have those two together. And unfortunately, when you split services like that, sometimes it's hard to move them forward in tandem, right? We had the services, unfortunately, we didn't have a lot of interest early on, but we have some new folks who have decided that they're interested in applying. So I think we'll have some good options for that. And, you know, I think that, you know, we all hope to get things done as quickly as possible, but obviously sometimes things take a little bit longer than you imagine, just as you start going through that process. So I think that just speaks to some of the challenges that Councilman Bingle mentioned regarding, you know, the timeline. I'm always a fan of let's pad the timeline as much as we can so that we can kind of come in on time. There's just been a lot that's rolled into this that has really stretched it. But I'm very excited to have this shelter come online, especially as we go into the winter weather, to be able to have some facility where we can have folks go during the cold winter weather, because we really struggled with that last winter, and I hope to not be in that position. So I'm very excited to continue moving this forward.
Yeah, thanks, Jen. I imagine it was difficult for providers not knowing who the operator was going to be, not knowing who your partner was going to be. Might have been a challenge.
Yes. We joked around that we needed to do like a provider speed dating where they could all come in and like have little discussions with each other. I think also the very first RFP, because this is our third release of this version of it. In the first RFP, we didn't even have the location identified. We were in talks with that location, but it was not fully confirmed and we did not put it in there. So I think that also led to some challenges where, you know, folks are maybe disinclined to put in an application for something where they don't know where it's going to be located.
Yeah, absolutely. I had one other question just about the operations, because I think that some of the discussions have changed a little bit. So did I hear right that there's some work to create some different sort of privacy and some different storage options from what the original plan was.
Yeah. So as we proceeded with this initial Commerce discussion, one of the things that came out of that was that Commerce had funded a congregate shelter out of Olympia called Interfaith Works. And when we talked to them about why they funded that, because their initial feedback was that we want permanent housing, right? But when they funded that, they said the reason why is because it was a very popular shelter, and they explained the way that it was run. It had more private spaces. People have kind of a cubby to themselves in like a little kind of group of other cubbies where they can put their baggage in a locked place right next to their bed. They don't have to lock it up someplace else. They have a curtain. They have their own light where they can have a light on maybe after all the lights have gone off. And so we really took that and said, well, why don't we take this as an opportunity with this additional funding that's coming through to expand the scope of what Trent could be, and really look at how do we make it a facility that people want to line up to get into and utilize this model. So we did propose that. I haven't had a lot of feedback. I've heard that Commerce is a little on the fence about the Trent shelter and providing additional funding for that. I'm a little saddened by that because I think some of the negative press and the negative feelings about that location are kind of presiding, and we're not able to get that message out that no, we're looking to really change how this operates and what this looks like. And I don't know if that's landing with folks out in the community. So we still have quite a bit of opposition, and Commerce is really looking at, you know, what does the community feel about these projects? And if there's a lot of opposition, you know, they may not decide to fund it. So some of what we would like to do at Trent is contingent on having additional funds to support it. We have the availability to do some modifications with the budget that we have, but we don't have the availability to do all the modifications that we want. But that was something that I got really excited about, of taking something that, you know, had a lot of contention, and how, as I keep saying in multiple meetings, how do we make it a yes, right? We have a location, it's identified. How do we make it a place that people are going to want to go? And I hope that we can get there.
Thanks for that, Jen. Catherine, I think you put your hand up.
So Jen, what you said spurred a question in me about winter shelters, because if we have 600 people in Camp Hope, there's no way the Trent shelter is going to make a big dent in that in time for winter. I know there was a discussion, and I think a working group actually from a group in Bellevue, Seattle area, that has a program that they've been very successful with. Is there any continued conversations with those folks? Is there any way of thinking about winter before we get there so that those people aren't left out?
Yeah, thanks, Catherine. You know, I think really the goal of this, the right-of-way funding, the $24 million, is to get those interventions up and running in the next 3 months. So for instance, that Quality Inn, 88 of those units should be available before the winter weather sets in. For those folks, and with some of the other interventions as well, they would be available before the winter. So I think between the interventions that we've proposed to Commerce and then the additional space at the Trent shelter, that would cover that full number. I'd have to look at the actual total number of beds that were proposed throughout the entire Commerce application. But really we're utilizing that $24 million to try to get most of those folks permanently housed if we can.
Yeah, I've only been able to come up with 300 beds. You know, maybe three, well, I'll be generous, 350. And if we have 600 people, that's not going to be sufficient. And I do think, I mean, we have tons of land, frankly, that WSDOT has not used, which could be modified if we wanted to deal with those kinds of situations on a permanent temporary basis. Things that are more substantial than tents, but not going to be long-term is what I'm thinking. And that's where that group from Bellevue was really talking. but it does take time to do. And if we wait until September to address it, we will not have people in shelter when it's cold. So I'm just wondering why. I mean, we're so focused on commerce, and that's nice. But are we using it for winter shelters? Are we thinking about it for that? Is there other funding available? I mean, I'm not hearing any talk about that at all. It's mm-hmm. all trying to get Trent and Commerce together, and there's nothing wrong with that. Yeah. But we can't drop out the people in winter.
Yeah. Thank you, Catherine. I really appreciate all of those points. And I would say that we never stop thinking about what to do about giving folks, everyone who is currently on the street, a place to go when it's cold. We looked for a location for quite some time to even secure Trent, right? That whole process probably took about a year. So finding land and finding places where we can put those is very challenging. And you can see that just through anytime there's been, something out there about a shelter or space going up, there's a lot of community opposition, and we have a lot of challenges with that. So I don't think it's for lack of wanting to find a location. It's just that we have not continued to find additional locations to support this. And then I think the second part is that we don't have additional funding to support it. So we have the funding that we have, and I correct me if I'm wrong, because I was not here when this happened, but did the Spokane Municipal Code that was requiring the warming shelters come into play after we had already allocated our five-year awards? Yes. So yes. Thank you, Adrian. So our five-year awards are our most flexible dollars, and we have those locked up for 5 years. We don't have additional funds to continue to open shelters. If we can get additional funds, we would love to spend them, trying to, work on this issue to have more options. But unfortunately, we just don't have the funds, which is why we've been really focusing on the Commerce dollars and the Trent shelter, because both of those things are already essentially secured. So let's get some more money, right? Let's find that.
Thanks, Jen. Karen, your hand is up, but I don't know if it was still up from before or if it's okay. It's all right. All right, any additional questions or comments for Jen? Okay, thank you so much for the updates. So we already did the council updates, and this got mentioned in the council update, but for committee updates for affordable housing, the first update is that the $10 million in funding that went through the Affordable Housing Committee and then through this board, those recommendations moved forward, and City Council has moved forward with our recommendations, which is great news. And I want to just say that I appreciate all of the hard work by both city staff and by the Affordable Housing Committee members. And then we spent some time unpacking all of this with the board as well. So I appreciate all of your help as well in moving this forward. There were some larger opportunities that we weren't able to move forward because that, if you recall, the proposals were supposed to indicate that they had matching funds, but the side effect of not getting some of those bigger things done, well, first of all, some of those are getting funded in other places, but also this really gave us an opportunity to give some funding to some smaller organizations that we've not had the opportunity to give funding to, because oftentimes these proposals come with a minimum or we're looking at how many people are impacted. So I'm really excited about some of the new partnerships that we have and excited to see how this funding goes. And as a reminder, that was, I think it was $6 million that was in ARPA funds, but $4 million were in those two taxes. So that will be ongoing funds that will build up again and be able to offer again in a future RFP. So thank you for your work on that. It's really exciting that was able to go forward. And I don't know, I know George is in a loud location. I'm not sure that we have anything for our August Affordable Housing Committee meeting. I haven't heard of anything yet. So for those of you on that committee, we will let you know if we're having that meeting. But at this point, I don't think that there's anything that we have for the Affordable Housing Committee this month. So, Karen, anything for evaluation and RFP?
No, fortunately for this interim director chair, there is nothing on the RFP committee's plate right now. The DOT right-of-way funds that we've been talking about aren't HUD, so we don't have to review those. And the other work, we thought that there'd be something under the $10 million, but the Fair Housing Committee handled that. So we are I'll probably have a freak out when we finally do get some work to do, but I have a great team to support me and help me through it, and we'll do a good job when it happens.
You know, Karen, I might suggest, and Jen, I might suggest that I doubt it, they could come together before, but given the RFP committee was the home for the five-year RFP previously, perhaps they can set a meeting afterwards and get a similar report of that we're going to get at the board retreat, with sort of saying what we funded, why we funded it, where we were, and then maybe they can also take a stab at some of those priorities and things. If they do it after the retreat, informed partially on some of the things that we as the board suggested, but that committee might be able to refine that and provide some extra expertise in helping with those priorities.
That's a great idea. And also, I know Barb had a tentative interest in joining the committee, but the question of meeting times and how to get a time that works for staff who need to support it, as well as for board members who would be willing to serve. So hopefully when our chair gets back, she may become our board president. And so I don't know how long this assignment will last, but hopefully we can just set us up for success, and that background information you just suggested would be great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Could you do that,
and
Jen?
Barb,
I'm sorry,
Barb, we did bring this up in the executive meeting. And one of the things that Jen was going to do in all of her extra time with all this other stuff that's been going on in the last 2 weeks, but one of the things that we asked is for her to sort of help us identify if there would be staff to support times that are a little bit more equitable for all of our members to be able to have an opportunity to serve on committees. So that is something that we have worked on, and executive is following up to make sure that we're providing opportunities for you to bring your expertise to the committees.
Yeah, I just, I might say in this, I've thought that, you know, when you're recruiting members for the committee, it would be real useful to know what hours really would be needed. I mean, originally all I knew about was the hours of 4 to 6 for this meeting, which was not a problem at all. And I didn't realize that I should have been available at other hours.
Yeah, that's really helpful. And affordable housing has had a time set for a long time, but it is not really accessible hours either, unless you have hence a lot of retired members on that committee in particular. And that actually, Barb, to your point, is what prompted us to move to the executive committee to 4 to 6, because it used to be in the middle of the day as well. It's like, well, we've sort of agreed to being able to be available in this late afternoon, early evening, and that might make more sense going forward. So we'll definitely follow up with that. Jen, I see you've had your hand up.
Sorry, yes. I just wanted to say, Karen, that actually we will have something coming for the RFP committee, and that would be for that services provider contract for the Trent shelter. So what I will do is I'll go ahead and it'll probably be tomorrow. I'll send you a tentative timeline of when we would be looking for the RFP to review, and we could kind of discuss getting that on the table. So I don't anticipate we'll have a large volume of applicants, so it shouldn't be a huge lift, but I will be calling on the RFP committee to assist with that.
Great. And we'll wait to hear the response timeline from you when you put that forward. Thank you very much for the heads up.
Yes.
All right. For anybody who's on the Affordable Housing Committee, but does not have the chat open, George did put in the chat that there will not be an Affordable Housing Committee meeting in August, but we will be reviewing the SNAP housing rehab program in September. So we will have a meeting in September. Announcements. I'm going to start with two announcements of things for you to look forward to. And if Kim is on here, Kim, please correct me if this changed. But I know that we found out that the open meetings, watching the video and signing the thing, you only have to do it every 3 years. Unfortunately, when they looked back to see when they were last, they were signed, for some reason, the record showed 2014, which isn't accurate for really any of us. So we do need to, I think we still need to redo that. So I'll work with Kim to hopefully get that sent out, with the exception of Barb and Karen, because I think you did it as you came on. And so yours seem to be up to date. And I think probably the council members are up to date, but the rest of us need to go through that, watch that video again and sign that. And then also we have the conflict of interest form. I don't think we have those signed by folks. And so those are gonna get sent out as well. The goal would be to have both done before the retreat. The conflict of interest forms is two sides. The first side is just where you're signing it. The other side is where you can sort of list some of the places of employment and or places where you're serving on boards or serving as a paid consultant, just so that we can make sure that we're double checking in case there are any conflicts, so that we can bring our attention to those and sort out how to resolve those. So that form will be sent out. And my goal would be, Kim, for us to send both everything out at once so that it's not multiple emails that you're trying to keep track of. Kim, is that still correct about the open meetings?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I think we got fancy and did something electronic last year, and then it made all of our dates 2014. So we will have to do that one again. But
yeah, I think that they were using an old template on accident, and then I have the new one now, so it'll all be good. But yeah, that was what happened. I found that out actually with Karen and Barb, because at first theirs were the same way, and I was like, wait, what happened? And then that's when we went back and checked and found out everybody's were wrong. So sorry about that.
And for those who don't remember, it's a very exciting, like, 20-minute video that just sort of walks us through, you know, what we can and cannot do, things that we have discussed before. But if you would just take a little bit of time to watch that and sign that document, that would be great. Any other announcements for the good of the board? Right. Seeing none, do I have a motion to adjourn early?
So moved.
Thanks, Bob. I thought maybe everybody wanted to stick around for a while. Yeah. Thanks, Bob. Do I have a second?
Second.
Jordan, thank you. All those in favor, raise your hand or say aye. Yeah. Anyone opposed? Any abstentions? All right. Thank you all so much. And I look forward to seeing you at Project ID for the retreat in September. Take care.
Nice meeting everybody. Nice meeting you.